Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. It is an absolute honor to be here. I spoke at OFFF a couple years ago. I absolutely loved it, and I thought we'd never get back here. So it's so good to be up here and see all your faces. Thanks for coming. I hope you enjoy this. I try to have a little bit something for everyone. You don't have to be too technical, but we are going to cover some tech stuff. I try to talk a little bit about some theory behind some of the design stuff as well, where I think things are going, how we use Houdini, all that kind of good stuff. As I said, I'm Will from the Mill. Never work at a company that rhymes with your name. You may notice I sound a bit funny. I'm from two places. I'm from the US and from the UK. I've moved back and forth a few times in my life. I've been back in the UK for about 20 years now, and I work at the Mill in our London studio. And I am a design director, and I've recently made a bit of a shift in there, but most of the work I'm going to be talking about today is part of the Mill design team. So motion graphics and all kinds of cool design stuff. I was asked yesterday by Chris, actually, what my philosophy of design is, and I missed probably the most important thing, which is make what you love. Design around what you love. And I love nature and the natural world. So for me, you know, designing things that feel like they're inspired by nature is really a treat, and I enjoy it. So here's a little example, just a series of idents we made for Al Jazeera English. And about half of this stuff was made purely in Houdini. Big shout out to Tosh Fieldson, our art director on this project. He did an incredible job, along with a small team inside the Mill. I call this slide my it's never too late to change your mind slide. This is basically a snapshot of my career. I've been doing this stuff for a long time. I started out in live broadcast TV back in the US. Used to be the guy who sat there and punched all the different cameras when they go camera one, camera two, that was me. I got into editing, and I decided I wanted to get into editing more seriously, so I moved to the UK and got a gig as the second assistant editor on a film called Billy Elliot, and following that, did a lot of work in the cutting rooms around London and did a lot of documentary editing. That stopped one day when I realized I was cutting a reality TV program called Celebrity Disfigured, and I said, I gotta get the hell out of here. last thing on here is the first 3D proper 3D thing I made. It was a spec spot I made for fun for Amnesty International. Amnesty International picked it up, and I went to Ireland, remade it. It became an ad they showed in cinemas for about a year, and it kind of launched my motion graphics career. So those are sort of the three careers I've had so far, and I've recently kind of shifted into a fourth, which is moving into interactive work. So I'm now part of the Mill's experiential team, and I'm designing for interactive projects. Like this one, these are my concept frames for something called the Death Stranding Wall. This was inspired by the game Death Stranding by Kojima Studios. So this is a artwork that you interact with, and it's traveling around the world. It's currently in Sydney, Australia, I think. So these things, you know, they have a life. They live and breathe. They're not just films. You actually can, you can change the outcome of what happens in these things. And for me, that's very exciting. The other thing I've been working in quite a bit is big screen stuff. So I'm going to talk a little bit about a Winter Olympics closing ceremony project we did with, you know, just trying to get stuff working on a massive screen and explain a little bit what that's about. But first, it wouldn't be a mill presentation without a mill reel. So this is the mill experience department reel. So I called this talk, Houdini Made Me Do It. And I'm a firm believer that you should never let software tell you how to work. It's you make what you want to make and you find the tools to do it. But something's happened ever since I started using Houdini, which is my thought process has changed a little bit. I tend to think less in terms of shots, which you normally do in a visual effects world, and think more about systems and patterns. You know, this allows me to look more at the world in a term of like the repetition, patterns, what things have in common, stuff like that. So for instance, you know, this swirling thing here, sort of abstract, you know, kind of toothpaste looking thing, could also be a system that builds caves underground. Or it could also be a system that builds cymatics, something that represents, you know, abstract audio waveforms. And these things actually are all built the same way. They all use the same underlying principle. Because Houdini is such an open procedural tool, it's quite easy to shift these things back and forth. But what really is interesting to me is it changes the way you see the world around you. You start to recognize these patterns and the way that the world works a little bit differently. The other thing I'm really interested in now is not just making kind of shots, but building assets. So tools that become not just something you use once, but you use a lot. So it might be that you make this flower, it takes a little bit, or this flower generator, it might take a little extra time up front to make it compared to modeling a flower, but you can make shitloads of them just by tweaking some parameters, and that saves you a ton of time. So these are kind of two things that I'm really interested in looking at. The other main thing is creating tools. I'm not so interested anymore in just making shots. I want to make things that other people can use to make their own shots. And you know, I never really thought of that when I started using Houdini, that it was going to change the way I made stuff that much. The first project I'm going to talk about is this one, and I'm not going to talk about it in too much detail, but this is the Winter Olympics closing ceremony in Beijing this year. This is the bit where the current host, which is China, hands over to the new host, which is actually two cities in Italy, Milan and Cortina. Normally these things have like thousands of dancers in pretty colorful costumes. They're quite kind of, you know, big on pageantry. Obviously, because of COVID, they had to come up with something quite different. So the Chinese authorities, or I should say authorities, the creative people behind the event, created the world's largest LED floor and used that under the entire event. And we created material for about 8 minutes of that that played out underneath a piece of choreographed dance, which is something I hadn't done before. So trying to work on how you link together with the motion of dancing. The other thing that's really weird about this project is the first time I ever saw it properly was the first time the world saw it. We could never see it until it was actually put on the floor on the day of the show. Everything up until then was just simulations of what it might look like. So you can imagine watching this go out live was a little bit scary, to say the least. We did a lot of concept work on this, and this is some really great work by an artist called Dan Hooper. you know, this is what Houdini is amazing at, is just taking like an idea or a system and producing a lot of iterations from that system. And you can play around with a lot of detail, and you can mess around with it in ways to make it move. And it's just quite beautiful. It feels quite organic. These are some of the frames that I designed for another section, where we're just kind of linking together this idea that half of the world is about nature and half of the world is about technology and kind of civilization, the cities. So these are some frames I built. And you can tell looking at these, they're very procedural. You know, they're all about patterns, textures, noise, all that kind of stuff driving it together. I love this stuff. I haven't pushed a polygon in probably 5 years. I've just basically just do this stuff procedurally. Tricky thing with this project, if you look carefully, is at the floor, is it's made up of these little LED panels. They look like this. There were 40,000 of them. This is the resolution. It's difficult to read. The width of the screen is 15K. That's the biggest LED screen ever made in the world, we think. And we were generating somewhere around 8 minutes, 6 to 8 minutes of content for this thing. You can't make this in the normal way. You can't just render it at 15K and hand it over, put it on a disk, and send it to China and hope it's going to work. So we had to develop a lot of systems for flexibility. One of the systems that I looked at was basically, how are we going to get this stuff rendered? Because at 15K, it's massive, and it's just not going to render in time. Also, found out just before, with about 2 weeks to go, maybe three, the frame rate was 50 frames per second, not 25. Yeah. I didn't sleep much in January. So I just want to show you kind of how something, one sort of asset works in a system like this. By the way, what we did in the end was we created all our content in Houdini and we passed it over to Unreal for rendering. And I can talk a little bit about how we did that. So this is this pictogram section. And this is where we kind of wanted to highlight the kind of sports that would be featured in the Italian Olympics, whilst the dancers danced on top of it. And so the way I approach these kind of things now, these are my concept frames, is from the very start, is don't think of this as, you know, something that you might make in Photoshop or, you know, do once in C4D. Think of this as right now, you're going to make something that eventually is going to make 20 different versions of this thing. And what we found while we were doing this actually is with about a week and a half to go, is that the Italian Olympic Committee suddenly saw these and were like, oh great, let's have more. And we're like, well, we can't just keep making more and more and more. But they said, well, yes, you will. So we said, okay. Luckily, we'd built this system. And this is classic Houdini, if you've used it before. But this is you know, how you go about building something that basically will create an output that will change depending on what you put into it. And it's pretty much automated. So this is some clip art that we purchased to use for one of the pictograms. First thing you do is just mess it up a little bit, give it some kind of energy lines. So this is just taking that image in Houdini and just splitting it up and breaking it up. And then just taking that image and an Integma tutorial and using that image to drive the subdivision of this surface so that you get this kind of cool technical looking thing. And dead simple. And of course, all you do is change the image and you get a different result. And it works every time. So we just next thing we just did is animate these up and down. And the animation's kind of boring. So we run it through a part of Houdini called Chops, which is like a kind of signal processor. And in this case, it adds a jiggle to that. And suddenly you've got something that's a little bit more interesting. And we cached these out. We sent them to Unreal. We looked at other ways of doing that, but that turned out to be the easiest way to do it. And rendered them in Unreal. And basically, the speed of Unreal was such that the only real delay there was the amount of time it took Unreal to write each frame to disk, because they were 15K EXRs and they were huge. So we made loads of these, and that was kind of the way a lot of this project worked, was just creating content in Houdini, passing it on to Unreal in various different ways, rendering it out there. There were a few bits we rendered in Houdini, but frankly, it was kind of terrifying, and we tried not to do it that much. Okay, next piece. This is a totally mad film that we made for Riot Games. I'm just going to show you a quick section of it now. If it ain't got style, I ain't with it. I ain't with it. If it ain't got style. my favorite things about this film. But I love it. This is one of my favorite shots, and I made it just using the VDB tools in Houdini. Once again, just passing some artwork into Houdini, basically using that artwork to create some geometry, and then using VDB, which is really the most efficient way to create anything that's like this. It looks like it's kind of stretched clay. It doesn't really have a kind of a form that would work with a normal polygonal mesh. Do it in VDB. Houdini doesn't care if the mesh that you get out at the end of that is massive. So it's quite an interesting setup and quite simple. But the shot I really want to talk to you about is this one. If you look carefully, there are a lot of these little neon signs in there. And you know, they're kind of throwaway. They're not like the you know, the main thing of the shot. I started to make one, you know, as original concept, and we showed it to the client. They said, oh, that's great. Why don't you make some more of them? And we said, okay, and how many more? Well, this many. So they gave us all this artwork and said, can you make neon signs for every one of these? Okay, so Houdini to the rescue again. We basically built a system, or I built a system, where all you had to do was change the artwork and you got a new neon sign. So again, this is like classic Houdini stuff. This is the asset. It's not something that you would want to see like up close in a hero shot. It's quite kind of, it's not subdivided that much. The detail's not amazing. It's not a Rizon neon sign. See out there? Oh, never mind. But it's got kind of cool stuff that tells you it's a neon sign. So it's got these little wires that come off the back of it, and it's got bits where the tubes go black, and they bend and they go backwards, all that kind of stuff that helps you see it as a neon sign. So the way we did this was we just built a system that input the artwork and then created that neon sign coming out the other end. So if you see here, basically all I'm doing is changing the input file, the PSD, and you wait a couple seconds, and you get a new sign. That's it. That's all we had to do. So we took something that took, you know, would have taken probably half a day per sign down to something that took literally minutes. So I'll show you a little bit about how that works. We started with the artwork. So this came from our client, Riot Games. And then we just break that down into individual layers. So kind of like if you were silk screening it, you know, all the different little bits that go together. Layer naming here is really important because this is a procedural tool, so you want things to keep consistent throughout the whole process. So you get each one of these layers, go inside Houdini, where we've basically built this kind of plugin that just allows you to put in a new file and everything changes. So inside Houdini, we have all these different pieces of geometry that represent those different input files, those layers from the PSD file. There's an amazing tool in Houdini called Side Effects Lab. Actually, it's a series of free tools that come with it. Add functionality to it. One of them can import a PSD file and can import the separate layers from it. So all this is doing is going, okay, well, I need layer 2 from that PSD file, and I'm going to trace that and turn that into some tubes. This next bit is the key. So to get all that kind of interesting stuff that happens on the neon sign, where the little bit pushes back, it turns black, you get the wires, all that stuff, you need some bit of information from the artwork that's consistent across them that you can use to drive that decision. So in this case, it's curvature. So basically where the artwork was really bendy, or the wires are bendy, that's where we're going to attach those little wires. We're going to make the sign go backwards and all that stuff. So you can see there, just by assigning this curvature kind of threshold, we can select those points. Those get pushed backwards. They turn black instead of being the color of the artwork. And then you get this kind of base point to start with to do all kinds of other cool stuff. So for instance, if you want to make the wires start from each one of those little curvy bits. They go backwards, they go kind of extruded to the side. There's some rounding in there, so they kind of group together. You subdivide them so you get something nice and smooth. You get these, and then that becomes the basis for the next bit, which is we need holes through this little metal sign, because I put metal signs in the back to give the sign a little bit of kind of opacity, basically. So that same attribute that was driving where we put the wires is where we're going to have a little hole through the sign so the wires can poke through. And then there's going to be a little sort of grommet thing that can stick on there as well. And then, of course, the wires are going to go off there. And then you just basically got this sign that looks okay from a distance and has saved you a huge amount of time and allowed you to basically, you know, please the client, because basically they want all their different artwork in there. The girders in the background, they're determined by the aspect ratio of the artwork that comes in, and the whole thing kind of looks like that. See the shot again. We repeated a few of them because they're kind of hidden away in the background, but you know, they actually add quite a lot to the shot. They give it little spots of color here and there, make it feel more detailed, more fun. Here are the signs as we made them. And again, just you know, something that we cranked out pretty quick. Cool, so that's the easy stuff. Now I'm gonna get to the trickier, weird stuff, the stuff that I do for fun. So I am never or was never going to be a fine artist. I am pretty much limited in my ability to hold a paintbrush or a pen or anything like that. I have a learning disability that makes it almost impossible for me to write by hand. And that's always been a great source of frustration for me. But Houdini has kind of helped me do something similar and help me create something that feels like oil paint. So this is a setup that I built inside Houdini, and this is when I was talking about making tools that aren't just for shots or for me. These are things that I want to share with other people. And so, like I said, you know, in Houdini, you don't just make a shot. Why do that when you can make a tool? You can basically build a piece of software that sits inside Houdini that has all the kind of logical controls you'd want. So controls to make things, you know, blobby and wobbly, and control color, and do all these things in a way that's logical for an oil painter. This was not something I made, by the way, but this is kind of the goal. And because I love the fact that this stuff is just feels so kind of, you get the energy of the artist in it, right? You feel the kind of way they move the brush around. That's what I was trying to get into this, is that sense of motion and energy. So where do you start when you want to make something like this in 3D? Well, actually, you just break it down to what it really is, which is a bunch of motion over a piece of canvas, whatever, paper, whatever. So you start with the most fundamental thing, which is just that line, that bit of motion, that curve. If you want to give that some width, turn it into something that has width, you just make it a sweep. So you add some geometry across it. Then how do you give it the sense that it's actually been kind of laid down by a brush? Well, that's basically how hard the artist is pushing down or how big the brush is. So this tool enables you to basically take that pressure from the tablet and determine how wide the stroke is as it goes down. Now, this is kind of a key thing for the way I use Houdini and the way Houdini works and is so brilliant, is that you can link things together. So you can say, okay, I basically want to be able to control this kind of look of bristles, you know, on the paint stroke. So I've got this control called bristle count, which just controls how many subdivisions are going along the length of this piece. And then that feeds into other things that basically help you get that same control or basically add to that effect. So we've got the stroke, we've got the sort of extra detail in there. This is then added to, or this control then feeds into a noise pattern and how much that noise pattern is stretched along the stroke. And then that feeds into the color mixing because the bristles that are on top might have a different color than the bristles that are on the bottom. And all that stuff works together in a sort of automated way once you figure out how to connect all this stuff. Everything else about this is basically just trying to displace it, to deform it in different ways. So we've got that kind of leading edge that you get when an artist is pushing paint along a canvas. So that's just another control that displaces it upwards. And so there's a ramp that runs along this thing that determines, you know, how long that blob at the front of it is, how far it sticks out, how tall it is, how kind of distorted it is, how you know, what's the frequency of that distortion? Is it smooth or is it made up of little bumps? Like, you know, is the paint kind of grainy or is the paint really smooth and soft? And here you see it's just using, basically passing a color through the system, and later on that color is used to tell Houdini that's where you push it up. There's another noise that basically does the same thing but sideways, and that's what gives it that kind of really cool wobbly feel. And again, these things are all linked together and passed back to logical controls. You might have noticed, if you look carefully, that I've got all these things that are basically custom controls for a paint setup here. These don't come with Houdini, I made these. And it's really easy to do. You just go into the interface controls, figure out what kind of control it's gonna be. Is it gonna be like a slider or a spinner? What kind of values is it going to pass? Is it going to pass color or numbers? And then just put that into your system, give it a name, and then connect it to all the different things that it's going to do. Color works in a pretty similar way, as I described before. It basically takes two colors, mixes them together, and it uses that bristle pattern that I talked about before to determine whether which color is there. And then you can add a third color. And I was just trying to get that sense of like what it feels like to mix color on a palette and get that sort of messiness in there. And then I built another control which just says, I don't want to assign the color manually. I want to take the color off a photograph that's underneath it. So here's the system sampling one color per stroke, because you don't want it to look like the color is just coming through the strokes in the photograph. You want it to get one color each time. And one thing that's really nice about this is when you see it from an angle, it's got relief. You know, it's not just like a filter that's saying, you know, turning it into like a watercolor. This stuff's actually got height. It sticks up off the surface. In fact, someone who's been playing with this recently has talked to me about potentially 3D printing these, which I think is pretty cool. And you can see it's got an absolute ton of geometry in it. There's, you know, it's very, very dense. Houdini has no problem with that, absolutely fine. I mean, this is not the kind of thing you're gonna do, you know, it's gonna play back in real time, but it's absolutely not a problem to have that much geometry. So you can get quite cool things that look a little bit like paintings. This is, basically I did this process over a picture of my daughter. You can get kind of, you know, interesting sort of abstract stuff. But then what I wanted to do is actually take a photograph and not even have to draw the strokes myself, but figure out, get Houdini to figure out how an artist would paint this. So, you know, you've seen all kinds of things like style transfer and GAN and stuff, where it's kind of like, oh, we'll just turn this thing into a painting. I wanted this to be art directable so you could control it, but still there's a lot of automation there. So if you take a photograph like this, you then basically want to think the way an oil painter does, right? They find all the little shapes of color, the islands of color in that image, and then use those as kind of the original building blocks of the painting. Houdini can do this really easily, actually, just by using a node called cluster. It just goes and finds those little islands of color. If you use 2D tools like Photoshop, you probably recognize this as like a quantized piece of art. It does look like that a bit, but we can fix that so it doesn't look like that in the next few steps. So each one of those little islands of color gets traced. You probably can't really see it there, but there's a trace around that. Okay, so now, to think sort of abstractly for a minute, imagine there's energy going around those curves. There's like speed, there's velocity going around those curves. And then you put a whole bunch of points inside those curves, you get them to move following that energy, and you get trails. And so this is what happens when you do that. You start to get something that builds up and it becomes kind of like a map of the way an artist would have moved over the canvas at the time they painted the thing. And you get some really cool results. So you get something that feels like, you know, pretty painterly, you know, if you look at it close. And like I said before, it's got relief. You can turn it on its side and you can see that it's actually got a surface there. And in fact, here, if you want to get a sense of like that, you can, you know, make it really blobby and really get a sense of like something sticking off the surface. And I started to have a lot of fun with this. This is the beach outside or near my house. You can do kind of abstract stuff. You can create, you know, one version with it looking like really quite, you know, detailed and photographic, and another one where you can go really crazy with it. And it's no big deal. You just try, change the settings, wait for it to set it up, render it again, and you get something completely different. So that's, you know, painting. Trying to create something that looks like a painting. But as I said earlier in this talk, now this is like, once you've got something that works well, why not take it and do other cool stuff with it? So I said, well, if I can make a painting from a picture, then I can probably make a painting from data. And data inside Houdini take many forms, but one of them is just noise. So you can take noise and you can start to get these really cool kind of patterns of strokes that are doing, basically being driven the same way that whole system works, but just using noise instead of an inputted picture. And then, you know, I was playing around with this and I started to see, like, it's got a really lovely kind of energy about it, almost like calligraphy, like Arabic calligraphy. And, you know, of course, with these things, they're procedural. You can just keep trying stuff and trying stuff. You can see, you know, what looks good. Half the time it looks terrible, half the time it looks quite cool. And I just, you know, went to town with this stuff for a while. And then I started to think, well, what could I do with this instead of just, you know, say, oh, that looks cool and whack it on Instagram? And I thought, well, this stuff kind of looks like weather to me. So I built a system that could interpret weather in a kind of painting. And basically what it does is it goes online, gets weather data, brings that inside Houdini, and makes a painting. So you literally just type in the name of a city, it goes and gets the weather, you can give it a date, and it creates a new painting for you. And they're quite fun. They're, you know, kind of, you're not gonna decide whether you're gonna, you know, fly a plane that day based on them. They're not like, you know, data art, but you know, they're fun, and they do kind of give you a sense of a place, things like that. So I'm gonna describe a little bit about how this works, because in my mind, this opens up a whole new world of opportunities. So, but what I say before I explain that, I had no idea how to do this before I start. And I wanna also explain, I am a really lazy Houdini artist. I don't learn things unless I want to know them and want to do them. I don't fill my head with stuff that I don't need to do. And if I do want to do something, I have this kind of time and energy to figure out how to do it. And that's the key, that you can do it. And with Houdini, you know it's possible. You're not going to hit some wall. It's so extensible and open, as Mo said earlier. You know, you can hack it. You can get into stuff. So here's a little bit of idea of how this all works. And I hope it makes sense. It's, you know, starting to get into slightly kind of away from design and graphics and into more kind of data art, but hopefully it'll make sense. So first thing I do whenever I don't know how to do something is go on Twitter and ask a question. You know, how do I get, you know, data about weather into Houdini? And a good friend of mine popped up about half an hour later and said, well, you want to go to this thing called openweathermap.org. So this is a free tool, and it's one, it offers what is called an API. So APIs are, there are thousands of them out there. And they're basically, I think it calls, stands for Application Programming Interface, but you don't need to know that. Basically, it just means there's access to information that you can get for free and bring into your system. And it comes back in something that looks like this. It's a JSON file. It's just some really well-formatted text that explains exactly what it is. So this is the first time I ever saw this weather data come back in. I knew what some of these things were. I didn't know what some of the other stuff was. I had no idea how to get it into Houdini in an automatic way. So again, you know, go online, find someone who's done something similar. So there's this chap called David Call, and he had written tutorials on how to bring in JSON files through Python. So I don't code Python. I didn't, I don't, I still don't. Python's very easy to copy and paste. I basically took David's system, figured out a few things that needed to be rejigging, and then I was able to import the API information directly into Houdini. So you can see there it is inside Houdini. That's my Python script on the right. On the left are the attributes that it stored, or the information that came in. You can see it's all kinds of different things. It's words, it's numbers, it's colors, it's values, all that stuff coming in. You just gotta make sure you understand what kind of data each thing is. Once you know that, you can then play with it. So this is basically it working. You go in there inside Houdini, and you type the name of the city, and you'll get different values, and they come in automatically. So this thing is now not just like an art project, it's kind of living. It has a, you know, the opportunity to be something that could you know, extend beyond, you know, anything I do. I can give it to someone, they can play around with it. Once you get the data into Houdini, you need to start figuring out what it's gonna do. How is it going to affect the design in a logical way? So I wanna point out, like, this isn't like, you know, data viz. This is just me trying to make something pretty with numbers coming in. So I'm being quite loose about this and really subjective. I'm just trying to have fun. So these are the values that came in that I was using. And I whittled it all down to wind speed, temperature, time, cloud cover, and the main weather description, which is text, which is quite useful for flagging whether there was any precipitation or not. So you can see, again, they come in all kinds of different things, right? So there's this thing, these words, which we call strings. There's numbers that have decimal points, which are floats. There are numbers that don't have decimal points, which are integers. And there's all this kind of stuff, and I didn't know what any of this stuff really meant. Like, why is the temperature 277 degrees? That's really hot. So I had to figure that stuff out. And of course, there is an answer for all this stuff, which I'll explain. So the first thing I did was just break down the system into six different types of wind. And again, I was being really subjective here. You could build a system where it's just basically the wind speed drives the whole design. But again, I wanted this to look pretty. And frankly, if I had just left that open, I wouldn't have been able to art direct it that much. So I came up with six different designs for different wind speeds. And then I used a switch to take the wind speed strength and just decide which one of those, they're called VOPs, by the way, those nodes, gets used to design the thing. And the way I made sure that we never got the same pattern every time is it just added a little bit of randomness. It just took the time of day, and that always just tweaked the settings a little bit. It didn't tweak it enough to change the art direction, but just enough to make it look different every time. Wind speed doesn't link to precipitation, really. So for rain and snow, I just had a little bit of logic in there that checks. If the word rain or snow is in that description, then it has another switch that turns on the precipitation setting, so you get something that looks a little bit different. So this is a grayscale, basically, pattern based on the wind speed and whether there's precipitation. The next thing is to bring in some color to determine sort of the character of the weather. And again, I did a sort of subjective setup here. I just created basically five different systems for different temperatures. I quantize the wind speed, basically. That's what it is. You take, you know, a value that's somewhere between like 0 and 70 miles per hour, and you just turn it into, that's either a value of 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4. You just remap it to that, and then that switch decides which one of these things it uses. Temperature on its own doesn't really depict the color of the sky, so I wanted to integrate time of day into this. And that actually turned out to be something kind of complicated. If you're into coding, you might have seen the way that time is depicted here. This is called epoch time or Unix time. It's the number of seconds since the first day of 1970, which is a little bit scary for me because that's when I was born. So that is actually counting down my life on every computer in the world. So then again, it's just a question of taking that massive number, trying to figure out what it means in terms of time of day. And there's a formula I discovered that basically you can eliminate all the days up till today, and then you can then figure out how many seconds you are into today. And that can give you, then you can remap that from a value of 0, which would be midnight in the morning, to 1, which would be midnight the following day, or 24 hours later. And then again, that just drives the switch. For some reason, I decided to remap time into 20 values and not 24. Again, I was just being really stupid. But so what you see here are materials or color setups just based on that temperature and time information kind of mixing together. And again, like I said, this is very subjective. It's just me building lots and lots of gradients that I think represent different temperatures around the world. It's kind of what I call a brute force method. There's probably a much more elegant way to do this. Oh yeah, a little point here. If you use Houdini, it's very easy to think you're doing something wrong. It's very easy to assume that there's a much, much better way to do something. That is a very destructive way to think, I've found, because there is always a better way to do something. And the problem is that will stop you in your tracks if you think I'm doing this wrong. The better thing to do is just keep going. If it works well, fine. If it doesn't, fix it. If you want to later, come back and make it like really super efficient and fast. But don't stop designing or doing what you're doing just because you're worried that someone would tell you that it could be done better. Once all this stuff is plugged into my setup, it works like this. Basically, just change the city name. You just change the city name. There we go. And a moment later, it changes. And when I recorded this a while ago, it was actually nighttime in these places. So it'll take a minute before I think we get somewhere interesting. Boston, here we go. There you go. You got, you know, sun and rain, and it, you know, it's partially cloudy. I would recommend maybe a sweater. And this stuff looks really cool when it's printed, which is something I really like. These are Gicli prints done on some nice paper. And it just has a real kind of expressiveness about it that I love. And I think, you know, with the exception of a few little glitches here and there, you'd be hard-pressed to think that came from a digital design system. But actually, the whole point of this was really to make something interactive, and this is something I'm still working on. So I took the whole thing, and I moved it into Unreal. And that was surprisingly easy. You just needed to expose the parameter for the city name. Basically, what you're doing is you create an asset that goes into Houdini. You expose that parameter, and then inside Unreal, all you have to do is change that city name, and basically the same thing happens again. The only other thing is you need to create a material that can read the color coming in off the asset. really interesting kind of world going forward. Like, how are we going to make real-time stuff? Are we going to do it in a game engine like Unreal or Unity? Are we going to do it with some like really fast render engine inside Houdini? Don't know. But these options are out there, and there's lots of cool ways to use them. Last thing is just, again, you know, when you come up with something cool, like, what else can you do with it? So I said, well, maybe that same idea could drive embroidery. So I started to design, you know, instead of it drawing paint strokes, it just draws threads that are woven through a surface, kind of a canvas surface. And I thought, well, let's make some shoes. And so these are Vans that I designed, which I thought would, you know, kind of fun. Like, people could have their own Vans that use their own data, because data is a really interesting thing now. It's becoming like a commodity, right? You know, people are trying to tell you your data doesn't have any value, but actually it's one of the most valuable things you have now. So to make designs that are driven by this, your data, like maybe, you know, you took the information off your wearable from when the day you ran a marathon, and you turned that into some kind of design, and then you got some shoes that had that. Or even just like the colors from your favorite, you know, Instagram, or like sample the colors off your Instagram feed, something like that. You know, just something that's yours, and then you get this kind of unique thing. These don't exist, obviously, but it'd be kind of fun if they did. And yeah, that's it, guys. I've got time for questions. Very happy to answer them.
Oh, there's a question right in the middle. Very enthusiastic arm wave.
I actually have two questions, and okay. One is the same that I asked to the team before. First, you mentioned about asset management, and I'm wondering if you have already tools in place to catalog and tag the data that you are generating inside of the studio. What do you consider best practices for that? And if you are even like auto-generating new material and new outcomes out of all these assets that you have, I guess, already cataloged and tagged. And second question is, how do you manage training and learning inside of the studio? Because as you mentioned, that you are creating your own plugins, add-ons, and scripts and things. So yeah, how do you do it?
Okay. I'll answer the second one first. Training is a tricky thing, and obviously it's changed massively in the days of COVID, because a lot of training, what we had before, was just osmosis. That's how I learned Houdini, right? I was around really great Houdini artists who were there to answer my stupid questions. So obviously we're trying to get people back together again so they can learn off of each other. This is a very difficult piece of software to learn on your own. You will find there are stumbling blocks that you can't get around without some help. There's, of course, lots and lots of help online. Like I said, I went on Twitter. That's actually somewhere I get a lot of my information. We are subscribers to Entagma, which is actually an incredibly good value. And we use it a lot. And when we announced to the team that we had it, they were over the moon. It's a really good way of getting, especially people who come from a design world, getting their heads into this stuff. It's how I, you know, that's what I supplemented my learning with, was Entagma. There's also something called the CG Wiki, which is an incredibly useful resource, which is free. So we use those things. There are, of course, other training materials out there. One thing I would say, coming from a design background, is there's a huge emphasis on Houdini on effects, right? Like simulations and stuff like that. I don't touch that stuff at all. And obviously you can, but There's so much to learn about this program before you even get into that world. So I would say, you know, if you're into design, everything I've shown you today, bar one little thing, is made in a part of Houdini called SOPS. It's basically the 3D surface, you know, creation that we all know. I would say just start there and go for that. Now, I'm not sure I understood your first question. It's about managing data.
So I guess that you're creating a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
And a lot of assets.
Yeah.
My thing is that, do you have a DAM for that? Do you have a specific way to catalog your own creations and all your files and everything that is around it? And if so, if you have any smart, tools there, you know, to do the job, or even to start putting things together and create
So you're mainly talking about asset management, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So obviously the mill is a massive VFX studio, so we have pipelines and we have tools to make sure that we adhere to those pipelines. So we have custom Python tools in Houdini that save our files, submit them to the render farm, create all the naming, the versioning, so all that kind of stuff. And then of course that fits into our whole kind of archiving system. That's the mill. All that other stuff that I showed you today is basically me going, oh, cool paint thing, final version 5. You know? So it's a bit of a mess, to be honest, and it's hard to find that stuff. But we, as a company, we use other also things like F-Track and that sort of stuff. We could do it better. Sure.
More questions?
I have just one question, and that would be, how did you manage to render 16K in Unreal?
Good question. We just did. As far as I know, I don't use Unreal myself, so I'm on the kind of asset creation and pushing side. My understanding is that it was problematic in terms of like hard drives, and occasionally it would crash. It definitely did not like rendering MOVs. It was so EXR sequences. I think at some point we actually looked at some other file types to keep the file size consistent so that we could actually measure it across the thing. That was the hardest part, was just getting the files out. The rendering seemed to be fine on our workstations. One thing I didn't mention is that we had to upload these to China as a compressed movie file to part of our team who was in the basement of the stadium in Beijing during COVID, freezing, downloading this stuff with a 5G phone connection. Yeah. Again, I didn't sleep much in January. I hope that answers your question.
I have a question. How did you not have a heart attack? Other questions?
Came close.
Did you try the paintbrush method on an actual 3D model as well?
Yeah, so that's something a lot of people have been asking me to try. And I basically got it worked out. But one thing I didn't say is I share this tool. I actually sell it. It has to work perfectly before I can send it out. So I have it working. And it's actually not that difficult. It was just a matter of telling the system that basically because it all worked on a 2D system, it was all basically displacing upwards. Now it needs to displace opposite the mesh that it's being drawn onto. So you read the normals off the mesh that it's being drawn onto. So you know, if you have a head, you're drawing it on a head, it needs to read that surface and understand what direction it needs to move away from that surface. And I'm doing it. It works fine. Thanks.
Well, thanks very much, Will.
Cheers.
Amazing presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. Thanks.